Devon and Scotland with the natural talents of Bill, Kate and Simon. You're watching BBC Two.
And it's midway through the second week, which means it's just about half-time. So how have we been getting on? Well, it's certainly been end-to-end stuff. 1 minute we were winning, 1 minute losing. At the moment, I think it's just about even.
I think so. All of which means it's going to be a cracking second half, so hang on to the edge of your seats. It's Springwatch.
Right. Let us rest, will they, Kate?
They won't.
Let us rest. There's so much happening.
There is so much happening, and what we are hoping is that this barn owl down in Heligan has managed to find enough food to keep her three remaining chicks alive.
Meanwhile, up in Glasgow, the Fox family being stalked by Gordon Buchanan, and I know lots of people you're fascinated by and can't wait to see where he's going with that rather nice Sunday joint, by the look of it.
Yes, and thinking of Sunday joints, have a look at these. Yorkshire puddings, are they the food of choice for discerning birds? Find out later.
I think it's an art installation. I'm putting that in for the Turner Prize. Anyway, Simon, up on Isla, are you there? Lovely evening down here. What's it like up there?
Absolutely gorgeous, Bill. Thank you very much. Welcome back to sunny Isla. I've come right to the south of the island this evening, to a peninsula called the O. Those cliffs behind me there, those great sea cliffs, are home to golden eagles, to peregrines, and to the single parent chough family that I introduced you to in yesterday's show, if you saw it. Now, today we're going to find out how that lone male is coping with life, trying to raise the chicks single-handed. We're also going to have an update with our newest avian stars, our hen harrier family, and a story of what I guess is best described as a true birdie love story. And I'm going to find out why these ladies, or more appropriately, the things these ladies do, are so important to all of our chuffs and many other creatures here in Isla. I'll be back in just a little while. Back to Bill and Kate.
Ah, well, generally speaking, I don't want to be competitive, although he seems to want to be. I think we do have the cuddlier little birds down here, don't you?
I think we do.
But when it comes to cows, he's got the glamour. There's no doubt about that. Aren't they lovely?
They are lovely. I think we might be closely related, actually. Now, anyway, hang on a second, because we've got shock news. Let's go live to the robins. And there they are. Gone, as they say in Ireland.
I don't want to claim any great sort of psychic powers, but I think I almost anticipated this, and I remember watching them yesterday, and I said, well, robins always go before you think they're ready to, and that's precisely what has happened. In fact, not only weren't we ready, our cameraman wasn't quite ready.
No, not quite
we've got,
ready.
We've got some of the fledging. This is what happened.
Here they are before they fledged, Mum coming in, and what's extraordinary, Bill, is they've still got those huge gates.
Yep.
I mean, they just look like very new chicks.
They do. It's always the same.
No wings to speak of.
They can barely fly, and there's no tails. And that's the thing that...
Nothing there.
Very few birds leave the nest without a tail, I'll tell you.
But two of them already have. Yeah. And
that's right, yeah.
These two are the last two to go.
Off you go. He seemed to go up. This one goes up, but rather more laboriously.
Yes.
Go on. Up there. Quick, go on, quick. Get away, get away, get away.
You can climb, you can climb.
It's extraordinary.
Absolutely amazing. And even Mum looks surprised.
Said, where are they? They've gone. 1 minute they're here, 1 minute they're
here. Yeah.
And she's just checking. I like that. She goes back again.
Are they really gone?
They're really gone. Unless that was Dad, because they've been feeding together, so they might both have come in and said, they've gone, they've gone. They're leaving home, but not exactly, because the parents will now follow them.
Yes, this is what you say, although how they find them, again, yeah. Because let's just put it into context where that nest is. Mm. There it is. I mean, you can see it's really hard to see. Let's go to the wider shot. There we go. And what we really need is, a white circle. That's
there's,
it.
There's a nest. And a vast jungle, literally, for them to get lost in.
A vast jungle.
What's interesting, Kate, is that I mean, I've got the same thing as some people on the... what's it called? Message board. That's right. They noticed it. My robins have gone next door and disappeared.
Yes, I've got it right here. Snow Leopard Cat said that their robins did exactly the same thing as yours and ended up next door. Could that be for a particular reason, like the reducing the chance of predators picking up a strong scent left at a nest site?
Snow Leopard Cat, or whatever you are. Is it three of them or one? Animals writing to us now. Absolutely spot on, but it takes a predator to know that, you see.
That's absolutely right,
because the scent of the nest would be very, very strong, and also predators already probably looking at that nest have been, you know, so they know they're there, so they take them away quickly. And one of the amazing things is they go really deep, you know. I don't expect to see them for days.
This is the huge problem. Our wonderful wildlife cameraman, Pete, also known as Compost Pete, did go out to try and find those robins, and they had disappeared deep undercover.
I know,
but he was actually mobbed by the adults.
Mobbed by robins?
Yeah.
Well, that means they're fairly close by. It must have been treading on one, probably. But the thing is, they don't make a noise either. A lot of baby birds, you know, baby blue tits and baby great tits at the moment, in everybody's garden, I'm sure if you've got them at home, they're going, sissy, and you can hear them instantly, you know. And they're fed out on a branch, but the robins don't.
They absolutely stay still
and they stay quiet. And even the adults, you know, if you hear a little tick tick noise, that means they're a little bit worried that you're there. And that's probably what they're doing. And mobbing Pete.
Yeah, could well be.
Can't imagine a robin beating up a butch cameraman.
He survived to tell the tale. Let's go live to Heligan now. There's the box where our dramatic family lives, and the three chicks. And there are three chicks. In fact, that one looks like it might be eating something, which is a very good sign.
Well, the little ones by the door, they have this little corridor just where they come in, and we were very worried that we call it the medium-sized one.
Yes.
Compared with the other two. But it's at the front, isn't it?
Just to recap the story that we told you yesterday, the male barn owl has gone missing in action, presumed dead, and so the female is now having to feed them all by herself. And the experts have worked out that she needs to catch the equivalent of 9 voles a night to keep those three chicks alive and healthy. But not only that, she's also got to feed herself. So how did she get on last night?
It's the maths here, Kate. If you do them, I think the experts had figured out, you know, 9, assuming that they'd have 3 each.
Yeah.
But we felt the chances were that there wouldn't be 3 each.
But
it'd be 6-1.
The little one again at the front, so has learnt.
I think it's the other two have learnt not to eat their baby brothers. For God's sake, you know, I'm not that small.
Here's the really big one getting his meal.
And in a few seconds, I think. Just what you want to see. There's a female going off to hunt. And they're almost evening up, look, she
And the big
them.
One goes in. Oh, no, that's the sort of second
Yeah, second biggest. It's a bit
big
of a
one tries
now.
To take it over.
Little one having a pull. They're both pulling.
And you think, oh, no. Don't let that big one have another mouse.
Tug of vole or whatever it's called.
But the medium one does win the day.
There's a chance here because I think they're big enough to fight back.
Yeah.
See, when they're really little, I mean, they're totally helpless. And it seems awful and it seems extreme, but, you know, if there's a lack of food, then this is what they've been doing, as everybody watching knows. They've been eating the little tiny ones. But that medium one's still pretty big, you know.
Still pretty big. And the good news is that after that, the mum disappeared for a while, and what we're hoping is that she was actually feeding herself. So, fingers crossed for the Heligan barn owl.
Definitely. It's every flipping day. It's been nerve-wracking.
It has.
Mind, it's more nerve-wracking for them, especially the little ones. Talking of being nerve-wracked, as it were, young tawny owls have been out into the wild wood, as they say in Wind in the Willows. Here's the wild wood. Here's a chaffinch who is rather cross. And this is the key to finding young owls, or indeed adult owls. But these owls won't be flying away. But the little birds mob them. This is a chaffinch alarm call. That's a blackbird alarm call. And as you know, they're both really, really harsh. There's the owl.
They sound like someone hitting a bottle.
That's right, It's chink, chink either way. They always say, in the books, they say, chaffinch, pink, pink. Blackbird, chink, chink. But either way, it's clink, 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 clink.
And there's the reason for the alarm calls.
Well, you can see that. He's a savage blighter, isn't he? I mean, look at him standing there with his beak slathering. Oh, he's winking at us. One, I can see you.
But he wouldn't be attacking young birds at this stage.
No, he very rarely will, actually. I mean, owls get... I think I've always felt small birds are not very good at identification because, you know, they mob, basically, they will mob a predator that's a threat to them. But they make mistakes all the time. You see rooks chasing herons, you know, it's not going to happen.
Yeah.
And in this case, an owl very rarely... I mean, they're at night for a start. The babies are asleep, you know,
absolutely.
So the birds. So, no, it's not real danger, but anything with a hook beak, it used to be human's attitude too. Fortunately, it's only little birds.
It has changed. Well, little birds have got ideas above their station, it turns out, as well, because the tawny owl box, here it is now, of course, empty.
Yes. Sure.
And so there have been new families prospecting.
That's right. You see, this is the Lloyd Grossman book. What kind of bird would live in a place like this?
And this is absolutely ridiculous. I mean, how would a great tit chick get out of there?
Well, apart from anything else, they'd build an enormous nest, wouldn't they? This is more like it. Pair of jackdaws, they are opportunists. They will often take over somebody else's nest box. And the tail is trembling with joy and anticipation.
Aww.
You can't see it now. They cut it off. It's a bit too exciting. We don't want to get worked up.
No.
The tail was going like that.
Well, my tail is trembling with joy and anticipation because now it's back to Isla.
Thanks, Kate. If you watched yesterday's show, you may remember that we had a rather sad story of a chough that we think almost certainly had been killed by a peregrine falcon. It was all the more tragic because this chough was a female bird and she was one half of a pair that historically have been very successful, and they'd nested right here on the Oe for many years. Let's just remind ourselves of what went on there. She was discovered dead by Gus Keyes, the RSPB warden down here on the Oe, and it really is terribly sad. Gus and I went down to the nest site to see how the male was coping with the chicks. We didn't know at this stage how many chicks for sure were in the nest, and indeed if he was going to be able to continue feeding them single-handed. Now, we stayed at that site throughout the morning, and we were joined by a wildlife cameraman, and what happened next was really quite extraordinary. You may think that this is fudged for telly, but this is the truth. We were sitting, watching the cliff, and, well, just look at what happened next.
Because he's been in there a while.
Yeah.
Can you actually see the chicks at all from down below? Or... Oh, there he goes.
He's just come out.
That's him.
He just sat on top of the cave there. In fact,
that's a chick.
I think it is.
Is it fledged?
Possibly.
Let me get the scope on it. That is a chick.
Is it?
Yeah, 100%. Have a look, Gus. Have a look. Dull muddy beak colour. That is astonishing. We've just witnessed the fledging of the
family. I don't believe
family.
It. That's brilliant. I think we've just seen them. That must be them just fledging right now.
No way.
Yeah. Obviously, my date of incubation was completely wrong, so...
But how brilliant!
It really was extraordinary to witness for the first time these birds emerging, and it wasn't just one chick. One, two, three, four. Now, bear in mind, the male had been dealing with them single-handed for almost a week already, and they were looking in good form when they first emerged, but my goodness, they were very naive and very clumsy on the cliffs. My heart was in my throat the first time I saw them emerging. I thought for sure they were all going to tumble down, but no, they managed to scrabble around, and they were insistent, trying to follow the male, trying to beg. That last little straggler looked a little weaker than the rest to me. Look at the tail feathers on this youngster. I mean, they're only just coming out of pin. They're very, very underdeveloped, but you think it's gonna slip. It's quite comical, they're jumping on each other's backs to get to Dad, and he takes it all in his stride. What a father. Amazing stuff. There is a serious overtone to this because, of course, we know what happened to their mum, or we think we do. She was certainly attacked by a bird of prey, probably a peregrine. There are peregrines on the cliffs here, and those young choughs are a prime target at this time. They're naive, they're clumsy, and Well, as I say, so long as Dad is coming backwards and forwards with food, though, they stand a chance. And we've had such good weather since that very wet weekend when they first emerged. Things are looking very good. Now, we are going to follow their progress throughout the show. We've got a camera stationed down at the end there, looking at the very cliff where we believe them still to be, and hopefully during the course of the show we'll have an update. One thing is for sure, though, the male has been very successful as far as finding food is concerned, and that, in part, is due to all these ladies behind me and their cousins and friends. No, they don't eat cows, of course, chuffs, but they do come to the deposits that cattle leave. Cowpats are a favourite hunting ground for chuffs, not just our male, but the flocks of non-breeding birds up in the north. Now, they're not feeding on the cowpat itself. They're looking in there for all sorts of bugs, invertebrates, that might come to breed there. And they can get quite territorial about a cowpat, if it's a good one. And once a chuff has dealt with one, it looks like a bomb's gone off in it. Really is quite something. Now, just to prove how very rich a cowpat can be, I'm going to get stuck in and see what I can find. Oh, that's a good rich one. You probably don't want to watch this. See what I can find in a single cowpat. When you join me next time, I will show you just the sort of thing that these chuffs are feeding on. Now back down to you, Bill and Kate in Devon.
Now I've lost Kate, I'm afraid, and we've got some boy racers in the background trying to drown me out, but we're not going to let that happen. I just want to warn Simon, I don't want to scare you, mate, but the last time I went rummaging in cowpats, which wasn't long ago, was I found a black widow spider. True? That's where they are. I mean, I was in Arizona, I admit, but, you know, with climate change, it could happen here, so just be careful. Talking of change, actually, normally at this time of the programme, we continue our saga of Fox in the City, but we're going to keep you waiting. It's coming, but that's later in the programme. Right now, here's another saga about one of my very, very favourite and actually one of the most important little critters in the whole of the world. What could it be? There's a clue. Here you go. It's early spring in a Cotswold garden, and the sun is shining. But winter isn't long gone, and everything is still pretty chilly. But as the air and the earth heat up, a beautiful queen stirs from her long sleep and prepares to emerge from her underground hideaway. The queen bumblebee starts her year early. Late last summer, she found herself an abandoned mouse hole. And there she stayed hidden throughout the winter months, in a torpor so deep she was barely alive. Now she's slow, and she's sluggish. She's on the brink of starvation. But our queen has got a trick up her sleeve, which is going to kickstart her year. All insects are cold-blooded. This one, though, can raise her body temperature above that of her cold surroundings. Like a mammal, she shivers using her large wing muscles to heat up her body so that she can fly. That little furry jacket keeps her snug and warm, too. So, our queen is about to get away, quite literally, to a flying start. And she can beat all the other insects to a feast of early spring flowers. But she's still weak. She can't fly far. Whether she makes it through the next few days will depend on whether her home is surrounded by the right flowers for her to feed on. And luckily for our queen, this garden is very bee-friendly. She'll do anything to get her the pollen and nectar she desperately needs, even if that means breaking and entering through the side. As March becomes April, she continues to feed. But April showers are not good news. She gets soggy. She gets cold. It's impossible to feed. She needs to keep dry, and she needs to stay fit. There's new challenges ahead. Like, for example, looking for a new home. She'll search high and low to find the perfect nest site. It's not just for her. It's also for the unborn young that she carries inside her. Mouse holes are ideal homes for bees to take over, but our queen will consider just about anything that has the right features and the right amenities. Ah, now that is perfect. A bee box. Custom built. That'll do nicely. A desirable residence, if ever we saw one. As the spring warms up, other insects finally emerge from their winter sleeps. But our queen is one step ahead of them. Already, she's making a nest out of wax, ready to start a family. Daily life for our queen has now changed pretty dramatically. She's turned those first few wax cells into a vast network of chambers full of her offspring. Single-handedly, she has produced 100 or so worker bees, and they will now take on the responsibility of finding food for this rather large family. This, indeed, is boom time. The survival of the bee colony depends on us planting the right flowers. This lot are pretty lucky. During the summer, a bee's life is quite literally buzzing with energy and activity. But it's soon to be tinged with sadness. The queen now lays a few special eggs. Some of them will become next season's queens and others will hatch as male drones. When she's done that, her work is at an end and she will die. But it's a case of the queen is dead, long live the new queens. They will now mate with males from other colonies, whilst frantically feeding to fill up their stomachs with honey before digging in for the winter. Next spring, they will emerge and give birth to a new generation. The lifestyle of bees are amongst the most enthralling happenings in nature. What's more, it all takes place before our very eyes. In your garden, whether it's big or small. Here's an extraordinary fact. I didn't know this until I was told it relatively recently. Don't know whether you know it, Kate, and folks at home. I think prepare to be astonished. Bees are this important. They're absolutely vital to the pollination of just about everything, as you well know. You know, sort of vegetables, fruit, everything, trees, just about everything. And it was calculated by Einstein and backed up by various other scientists that if there weren't bees, if we actually, you know, lost all our bees, we, the human race, would also die out after about 6 or 7 years. That is how important.
Yeah.
Einstein got it wrong, actually. He exaggerated. He said it was 4 years, but the other scientists have said, no, don't be ridiculous, scaremonger. We've got 6 years without bees. That's how important they are. So that's how important it is to encourage them.
Absolutely.
And you can, fortunately, planting the right things. Put a bee box up. This is a sort of an official bee box from a merchandise shop, you know, somebody who sells it. There you are. It has the great advantage that the bee can actually get in the hole. Yeah, like that? There you are, it's gone in. Oh, there it is. It's got it. Not looking too good. Personally, I do think they're fairly expensive. They are very, very good and they're very ruggy, but...
Yeah, well, you can make a homemade version like the Springwatch trackers did the other week. This is fantastic. It's just chopped up bits of bamboo, which, of course, are hollow, all stuck into a flower pot. The other thing that I've heard people use, which is a really brilliant idea, if you have that horrible Japanese knotweed in your garden or your allotment, that's also hollow. So if you chop that down, you can chop it up exactly like that, like the bamboo, and the bees can go and nest in there. So thank you, Springwatch trackers, and don't forget to watch them at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning.
That's very ingenious.
It's brilliant,
two
isn't
things
it?
At once. Yeah, no,
yeah,
that really is excellent.
Really good idea.
Now the moment You've all been waiting for. Our birds have been waiting for. The nation hasn't, so definitely have we. We did, of course, have Jamie Oliver on, so was complaining that we were feeding our birds the equivalent of turkey twizzlers,
yes,
or something like that. So we challenged you all to send us delicious and irresistible bird recipes. Well, we've made a few up. I think Jamie popped down to the farm and did them himself last night, didn't he? But, or was it Gordon Ramsay? There was a lot of swearing, I know that. Anyway, this is the scene at the feeders. We've taken the real feeders away, and here they are. That's, who have we got first?
That's your
Couscous Delight. Mine is there with some other bits and pieces in it.
And that's my Fruity Lard.
It's Fruity Lard.
and there are the Yorkshire Puddings,
yes,
which apparently will get mopped up by hungry birds in 15 minutes or less.
So
what happened?
What happened? We've been monitoring. They haven't been out all day. We put them away. We didn't put them out last night because we thought the badgers or somebody.
So we've got Bill on the right there, yeah, me right on the left.
Come on, you birds, come and get it. Get your couscous. Couscous is Moroccan. They're not going to want this. We've got English birds.
Yes, I mean, surely they want black. Oh, no, you've got one. You've got
it?
A bird. You've
what
got a grate on
it?
Your couscous.
Yes.
I don't believe
yes.
it.
Yes. That sounds rather a nasty. That's the name of my autobiography, I think. Grate it on my couscous.
But the Fruity Lard may have failed, but did the Yorkshire puddings.
And they said, what did she say? 15 minutes
15
it'll
minutes.
Last. They've been up there for, well, I was going to say 15 hours, but not quite that long. Has nothing taken them?
Nothing.
I can't believe this. You know, we've got squirrels, we've got all sorts
I
of things.
I know.
Oh,
maybe we
dear.
Just, maybe they just don't like ready-made ones. Maybe they want
yeah.
homemade Yorkshire puddings.
I don't know. Do you think it's the plates?
It could be the plates.
They like
could
the
be
plates,
just that
yeah.
our birds are too fussy.
Well, I'll have them later. Don't worry about that. send them up to Isla. They go very well with a double malt, you'll find.
But thank you all very, very much indeed
thank
for
you.
All your recipes. As you probably gathered, that wasn't the most scientific
no.
of experiments, and I'm sure that other birds would love those recipes.
It's other circumstances, I guess, you know, different times of the year, birds like different things. It's absolutely true.
Absolutely.
I can't think couscous is a spring menu, not for little babies, you know.
No.
And yours was a bit
yeah.
rich, wasn't it?
It was a
but
bit.
The thing is, blackbirds, for example, and especially when they've got youngsters, it's live food that's the premium at this time of the year.
There they are. There are three blackbird chicks that are being beautifully looked after by both adults. Lots of worms coming in, caterpillars, that kind of thing. But Bill,
come
a lot
on.
Of people have been asking about mealworms and
oh,
whether
yes,
this
yes,
is
yes.
a good time of year to feed them
yes.
and whether we do live or dried.
Well, it's the very best time of the year, apart from anything else, feeding in general. You know,
yeah.
it used to be this question, you better at opening these than me, but it's used to be this question, should we still feed the birds in summer? And the answer is yes, 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 and then again yes, because obviously there are more mouths to feed. There's all these babies around, so definitely put that food out. But I'm not sure. They're definitely dead. These are
they're definitely dead,
like
and they're
small
a little
twiglets
bit,
or something.
They are a little bit crispy.
Well, yes, exactly. So squeeze one of these, and it's not much of a sensation. In fact, it's completely hollow inside. There is no liquid. And the fact of the matter is that this is the way that baby birds get their liquid, by eating soft insects. You know, if you squash your caterpillar, I don't suggest you do it, but if you do and a bird does, that little baby bird is getting a drink, which he can't get until it actually comes out. So basically, at this time of the year, I would undoubtedly recommend live mealworms. They're really, really good.
However, I will say for my part that when I'm away from home and can't get live mealworms, dried mealworms are a very good second substitute.
Yes.
Now, one of the problems of putting food out is that it can result in, well, the occasional tussle. As yes, as Jamie Dixon in Angus filmed these two hedgehogs.
Yeah. Not between birds.
Now, what do you think is going on here, Bill?
I mean,
they look like the same sex because they're the same size.
I think so. It's probably a couple of males fighting over a mixture of territory or indeed food, you know, because whenever you get animals in a garden, or very often in an urban or suburban garden, it'll be actually sort of follow on from the bird food. You know, at the moment, I have a delightful, I might say, family of four young rats. I'm
Aww.
Committing to video at the moment. They're very lovely, but there are people in our family who are not quite so welcoming to my rats, but I, at the moment, they're very good value. And, you know, I've also had wood mice underneath the... that's in the middle of London, you know, so
Absolutely. Now, last night, we met the wonderful Patrick Roper, who delighted many of you with his study of just 1 metre of his garden and how much he enjoyed the wildlife in that. Well, he's come up with another experiment, which anybody can do, whether they have a garden or not. Have a look at this.
I bought a window box and a bag of soil, potting compost, from the garden centre, and I filled the window box up and put a stone, a piece of wood and a little pond in it, and I just left it to see what plants and animals appeared in it. The plants that appear there, some obviously grow nearby, and they're familiar garden plants of ours, and they've seeded themselves into the box. Others, I don't know where they've come from. Some of the ones that I particularly like are this Herb Robert, and then I've got some Tucson here. There's a plant of that grows behind, so clearly some seed has got over and established itself here. Often this is said to be an ancient woodland indicator, so I like to think my window box is a piece of ancient woodland. One of the interesting things about the window box is you can move it. You can take it about with you. You can keep one on the roof of your car if you want it. Might take it up to Scotland one day and see if it attracts any Scottish species to it and then bring it home again. This is a project that absolutely anybody can do. All they need is the window box and some earth from the garden centre, and off you go, see what turns up in it. Great fun too.
Well, I'm delighted to say that I have been joined here in Islay by a very special guest indeed. It's not Patrick, but it is his window box, the very same one. And I sincerely hope it attracts some exotic guests all of its own before it wends its way back south. Now then, I was, just before you left me, I was going through this cow patch. Oh, I've just disturbed all the flies. Not a pretty sight, perhaps, but extraordinary how quickly, once I've exposed the fresh dung, the flies come straight back on and begin to lay their eggs. And this is what I've found since you saw me. And it's amazing how much there is. There's some earthworms, of course, but also a couple of species of beetle, 2 species of dung beetle that I found in here, a larva, it looks like a leather jacket, but I'm not quite sure, and many other bugs. That's exactly the sort of thing that our choughs were looking for when they go through these cowpats. I'll put that back down. They will go back home. You know, the dung is really important right through the year for the chough and other birds, not just cow dung, but sheep dung also, because it's like a larder, and it stores this fantastic resource of invertebrates, and it keeps them going. And it's really that marriage of farming and managing the ground for the wildlife that works so well here in Islay. Now, spring and summer here, of course, is a magnificent time, but Islay has a very, very different character through the winter months. Of course, the days are shorter, that goes without saying, but for me at least, one of the most marked changes in the year happens in late October with the arrival of the geese. In the winter, Islay is home to almost 50,000 barnacle geese. They come down from Greenland, where they've been breeding, to spend the winter here grazing on the pasture. Much of the land here is managed in a cyclical way, so there's always good grazing for these geese. And historically, they've not been hunted here, so they find safe haven throughout the winter months. Then, come early April, they all leave. They head back up north to Greenland. About 65-70% of the Greenland population spend the winter here. That's 15% of the world's population. So come the spring, those great flocks go, leaving the coastline to the skylarks. Not a sound of a goose, a very different atmosphere. Not one goose to be seen. Well, that's not strictly true, because we have been seeing one goose on the shoreline here, a rather lonely figure. We think she's a female, and almost certainly she has a broken wing. Her right wing is hanging. So that explains why she can't join her colleagues on this great migration. What a lonely sight it is. Well, actually, that's not strictly true either, because she does have someone with her. I think this is a male goose, and he appears to be fully flighted and in good health. I can't tell you for sure that he is her mate, but it does seem extremely likely. And if that is the case, what an extraordinary display of fidelity. He could go up north with the rest of them. He could go up to Greenland and find another mate and breed. But instead, he chooses to stay here and stick by her side. That, for me, well, you can draw your own conclusions, whether birds have feelings or not, I don't know. Whatever it is that's keeping that male bird by the side of the female who hasn't the capacity to fly, that's your conclusion. I know what I think, but an extraordinary story. And they sit there peacefully alone until the autumn comes once again and they're joined by thousands. They'll just get lost in the crowd. Now then, you may have been following the fortunes or misfortunes of our live eagle camera as we've been going by. We've had all sorts of trouble with condensation since the weekend, trying to get live pictures out of the camera. I'm going to give you an update of that later on in the show, but we did send a wildlife cameraman in to get a record of what was happening in the nest, because it was so frustrating that we couldn't see what was happening with the chick. Let's catch up with what he saw just the other day. This is from a hide looking back in. This in fact is footage from a little while ago, just to bring you up to speed. That's the chick when we first saw it. The first view we had of the golden eagle chick, very small, still covered in white downy fluff and being tended to by the adult female. She has to tear up the prey. Then as the days go by, you can see quite rapid developments. The weekend, of course, mum spent the whole time as a living umbrella sheltering the chick. But you can see that there are feathers coming out along its back. And so what is it looking like now? Well, this was just yesterday. And already you can see it's beginning to look like an eagle. Mum's having difficulty moving around the nest without being coated. She always looks surprised when that happens. And she still is, the adult female is still tearing prey for the chick, but the chick is beginning to feed itself. That's all we have time for just now, but I will definitely be back with live images from the eagle nest in a little while. Back down to Devon.
Thanks, Simon. And from very big birds to very little ones, if you were watching last night, you will have seen that one of our six wren chicks almost took a tumble out of the nest. Well, this is what happened today. There they all are, looking quite sleepy. Yeah. Until the mum comes in to feed.
How many are in there, Kate?
There are six altogether, although we can actually only see five there because they are quite squashed in.
So this is ever so sad. What goes to happen now? I can't. We had a cruel producer who founded a Comedy 4. I don't think that was nice. It's horrible.
So here she is, but you can see one just on the edge there and it falls.
Blimey. Well, the mum actually knocked it off.
I think she did. Let's go over to them
just
live.
Just make sure they're all right.
And there they all are.
Can I just tell you a quick story? I'm sorry to interrupt there, but I just remember this. When I was on Bird in the Nest a few years ago, we had some robins nesting in a precarious place. They were in an outside toilet over an open loo, and this is absolutely true. We got people writing in saying we're really worried they're going to fledge straight down the loo, and so we put over the loo a sort of cellophane cover.
Yeah.
And we thought this is going to be even worse because they're going to fall out now and bounce on it. But you know, and myself and the other presenter, we just giggled. We couldn't talk about it any longer. But we're not laughing at that, and I don't think that's the answer with that poor little wren. I think he's had it.
He has, I'm afraid. But we've still got five left, so hopefully, Mum won't knock any more out of the nest.
No.
Now, Pete, our cameraman, may not have been able to get robin fledglings, but he did manage to get this fantastic footage. This is a great bird.
Yeah.
It is a nuthatch.
There it is, yeah. And he's got a nut. And this is an adult doing what nuthatches sometimes do. They do all sorts of fascinating things, actually. But there he's using that as a sort of wedge, an anvil or whatever. You know, it's not an anvil, it's a vise, isn't it, to put the nut in. And that's what he's doing there. And they'll also root around for little bugs and things like that. But the babies...
Oh, it doesn't quite know what to do, does it?
No, they're not very good, actually. It's not surprising, because it had a very sheltered life, because whilst they're in the nest, they don't get to look out of it, because nuthatches, amazingly, use mud to sort of concrete
them. That one looks like it's tucking an insect back in.
I think
sort
it probably...
Found an insect at all. I don't like you.
A stash. They probably said, well, you do, you hide food for later in the year, but not the things that can wriggle away. But they haven't got that. You know, they'll learn.
They're only little. Yeah. Let's head back down to Heligan now, but not to the owl box.
Oh,
this is a blue tip box.
Yeah.
And inside...
Is?
Is?
A nest, but... That is not a blue tit's nest,
no,
I promise you.
It is
no,
not a blue tit's nest.
I can tell you what that is. Well, you can know what
there,
it is.
It's a sparrow.
And that's typical, Kate, of a house sparrow's nest. I mean, I remember when I was a kid seeing these nests all over the place. And they're always messy, which is weird, because these birds, house sparrows, are related to weavers, which you've seen, haven't you, abroad? You
know, they, absolutely.
And they build a meticulous nest.
They look like basket weavers.
Exactly.
They're absolutely beautiful.
Yeah. So I think the house sparrow got drummed out of the weavers club, basically.
So because they're
build
just so messy.
Well, look at the state of it. It's
I know.
Appalling.
It really is. Yeah. Let's go and see this little bit of film now that has shows that squeezing in is a little bit of a tight fit, that.
Yeah.
But it is does seem strange, Bill, that there's not a colony of them, because sparrows do look like weavers.
Like weavers,
tend to nest with a bunch of them together.
The simple answer to that is, I think, you need several sparrows to form a colony. When I was a kid, and they were a lot commoner, I would see a sparrow colony in weird places, like the edge of a heron's nest, even an eagle's nest,
wow.
You know. And they would have several of these messy, great, lumpy nests in there. So when there's plenty of them, they're colonial. That's the male, by the way. But the simple fact of the matter is, house sparrows in some parts of the country, cities in particular, and possibly down in this area, are not that common.
So you just simply don't have the numbers to have a colony?
It's not that they don't want a colony. They're lonely house sparrows, probably.
We'll be keeping an eye on them because they're still sitting on eggs, so of course when they hatch we will let you know. But now we need to head back up to Glasgow because Jamie, the old dog fox, has been giving poor old Gordon Buchanan the run and round. Will he let him near the cubs tonight or will he keep him in the dark?
I've been watching these foxes for a few weeks now. The Chipshop family seem to be in good health. But the cubs are becoming increasingly adventurous. Old Jamie showed his face for the first time in 10 days, but then quickly gave me the slip. Will he ever let me get close to his cubs? Jamie's still lying low. He seems to have found a new home at the local hospital. It's perfect for him and his family. It's private, and I for one can't gain access. I have to respect the fact that if Jamie wants to keep his family hidden, then that's fair enough. The last thing I want to do is disturb them. But I'm still hopeful that he's going to let me back into his life. Aha, who's this? Is it Jamie? Well, he's definitely marking his territory.
I don't think that was Jamie. That just seemed a little bit too radical a manoeuvre for him. But he's in Jamie's patch.
Maybe a sign of things to come for old Jamie. Other foxes are already waiting to grab his territory. Ah, there you are, Jamie. Are you still going to play hard to get?
Hey, Jamie. There you go. Jamie. Jamie, look what I've got. Jamie, look. Don't turn your nose up at worms. Jamie, that's what real foxes eat. You snob. Eat it. Good boy.
Oh, don't run away again, Jamie.
Don't know where he went. Don't know.
I've lost him again. And over the next couple of nights, I catch only quick glimpses of him. One thing I've learned about foxes over the last few weeks is that if they choose to shut me out of their lives, in a moment, they can just vanish into their urban jungle. And there's nothing I can do about it. It's such a different story with the Chipshop family. They seem happy to let me watch them anytime. This lot seems so relaxed and confident, living right next to people. I mean, just look at that. And Mum's back out looking for food again. And we've got cubs, there we go, two. Hang on, that Mum's back in again. And I don't blame her. Who's this? Ah, that's Mungo. The adventurous one. No, Mungo, you're not going to head out by yourself again. Maybe he's learnt his lesson. And somebody's come out to join you. There's one of the adults. What's happening? Wow, look at this. That adult's taking the cubs out onto the pavement for the first time. Things are very different out here, but the cubs need to learn to find food for themselves. What a big moment for these cubs. It's great to be watching this. I wonder if this will attract their attention. Hey, cubs, this isn't a time to play. There might be a meal in there.
Take that, you bag.
It's nerve-wracking watching these cubs so close to the road. But this is going to be their life from now on. It's dangerous out here, and the statistics for urban foxes are pretty sobering. It's likely that only one of these cubs will make it to their first birthday. Is Mum going to keep them out of danger?
What? What's he say? Go to Badgers. Go to Badgers.
Oh, quick. Are they on live?
Brilliant. Yeah, apparently.
Oh, yeah, they are.
You know, we come away from the farm. This is what happens.
Is that two? There's one at the back there.
I don't know. I'm not even sure it's a badger by the look of that.
It looks like they're feeding.
You see, I think the director, with greatest respect to him, gets excited just to see the back end of a badger. I think it's rather... I don't know why. We'll talk about that one later, but, you know, come on, drag us away
from
the...
Oh, but they are
live. It's all right, but it was better last night. Come on,
it was better last night. It was better last night. Let's have a look at what they were up to then. This is lovely. There's a cub here, and you could absolutely think, Bill, can't you, that he's... Where's me mate?
He's waiting for his mate. This is what they do. I mean, this is actually true. There's probably... He's got a best friend, you know. So they do split up. There's probably two families down there. We think
there's a huge number of cubs
down
there.
An awful lot, yeah. But they do prefer a best friend, you know, just like human beings tell all the secrets to him and have a bit of play fighting. It's could lead to all sorts of things.
Oh, it's
how they learn.
Lovely. It's absolutely lovely.
It is delightful. They are very playful animals. We asked our badger experts, you know, is there... yes, of course, there's some purpose to this, you know, agility, fighting, etc. But basically, they like playing.
It's
They're
just
kids.
Fun. Yeah. We're kids, we're having fun. It's just great. This is lovely as well, because it looks like Mum's saying, right, now then, you've had enough now. Come on.
Yeah, time to bed. I think that's exactly what's happening. Simon was saying last night you could see them taking bedding down because they have to clean it and keep it nice and clean. I always get the feeling, Kate, when we're away from the farm, that we're being watched.
Well, and I think we are.
Not by wildlife, but wildlife cameraman?
Yes, you know, Compost Pete has surpassed himself tonight. Not only does he spy on us, but he spies on anything else that he can find around the farm. And these two are roe deer.
This is good.
Beautiful, absolutely beautiful.
A couple of females. Oh, I always like this. You know, you get hinds in some deer, but in roes it is does, so they're roe does.
And these are the deer that you are most likely to see around Britain, and you're most likely to see them in your garden. Unfortunately, some gardeners are not too keen on having their roses pruned by roe deer. This one does a very good passing impression of a goat.
It's interesting, you can see, if you're in a woodland area where there are deer, you can see what they call the grazing line, which is under the tree. You know, it's like somebody, instead of somebody cutting off the top of the tree, they've cut off under the tree. So it's sort of flat, you know, right down. And of course, well, they do get into trouble, you're quite right, you know, for nibbling trees. Well, I think they're rather
a lovely sighting there. Now, Patrick Roper's window box may have made it all the way to Isla, but what about this idea for a mobile wildlife garden? This is taking place in London. There's a group of people here who thought, let's make a wildlife garden, but let's see if we can take it all around the town. It's an extraordinary idea, Bill. It's brilliant.
Well, this is what happens this particular weekend of the year when it's Springwatch Festival time.
Uh-huh, yes.
When they hit the road and the ideas come thick and fast. This is the London Wildlife Trust, I think, have coordinated this, and they'll be going off to the... Oh, and the Royal Parks have got involved. Thank you, Your Majesty. And they'll be going off to... With their mobile skip to the festival in London.
Absolutely.
And how many others are there?
Well, 15 other festivals, 13 going on this weekend, and as you can see, that Aston is crawling along the bottom to tell you where they are. I would head up to Glasgow to meet Gordon Buchanan, because he can tell you all about Fox and the City, but I know that you've got other
ideas. Well, my heart will be in Birmingham. I was brought up in Birmingham, but it's also being visited on, I think, on both days by Jelly from CBeebies.
Yes.
That lovely lady, your rival, and Detective Dan.
We're not going to listen about Jelly. If you go to Manchester, you can watch live footage of nesting peregrines on a great big screen.
And in Peterborough, you can learn how to become a Springwatch tracker. Now, those are for everybody. That's the main thing. This festival weekend is for all ages. Last year, 250,000 people came out. So this weekend, shall we go for a full million? Or is that too ambitious?
I think we should.
Half a million at least.
And if you want to know more and get all the details, you know what to do. You go onto the website, bbc.co.uk/springwatch. The address is there. Use it. Now then, shall we go and have a look at the swallows?
I think we should have something calm. It's been a little frenetic just now. We'd have to plug all these things, but we'd very willingly and we'd love doing it and we believe in it. But this is also where my heart is. I'm not with Jelly. I'd like to be with... I've always wanted to be a swallow. I think they must be so cozy.
Have you?
It's my favourite bird.
Now, we saw earlier a wren falling out of the nest.
Yeah.
These do look like they're almost bursting out of theirs. Is there a danger that we could lose one
There is. It does happen. There's no point in pretending it doesn't. Sometimes, even worse, the whole nest collapses, you know, if something gets up there or somebody inadvertently starts cleaning the roof. And these things do happen. And these boys and girls, I can promise, we'll have our hearts in our mouths over the next few days, because they will start to wander from that nest. You know, they do a sort of version of the owls on the branch, but the owls are branching, and this is nice, the swallows are beaming.
Aww.
It's not true, I made that up, but it's... but they do. They go onto the beams, and they'll be hopping around and practising there. It's brilliant. It's really good value.
We'll keep our eyes open for that, but now let's head back to Simon.
Welcome back to Isla on this beautiful evening. I've come down to the cliffs on the O Peninsula now. These are the very cliffs, and indeed the cave, where our single-parent chough family nested, that male who's trying to rear his chicks single-handedly. We've had a live camera trained on the site throughout the course of the afternoon just to see his progress. He has been backwards and forwards the whole time, visiting to feed the chicks every 30, 40 minutes or so. I don't think there's any view of him right now. I don't think he's visible at the moment, but we did see just a little earlier him visiting the spot. Let's take a look at how he was progressing. He was feeding on the fields right next to us, in fact, making the most of those cowpats, or indeed the little bugs and beasts that are living within them, then flying back to the chicks. Now, it was much hotter just an hour or so ago, and there's quite a lot of heat haze here, but I'm sorry to say that's the male on the left. He's fine, but only three chicks visible, as opposed to the four that we saw the day before yesterday and on the weekend. Now, it could be that one of the chicks is stuck somewhere up in the cliff, or even indeed back in the nest cave, but it's very likely that it has perished already. Now, that is to be expected, to be fair. There was one that was struggling, certainly, and it's perfectly normal whether or not there are two parents for, at this stage of the game, a chick to perish, and particularly when you bear in mind there are peregrines around, so who knows what happened to that one. I know from the message board, too, some of you have been asking, will that male go off and find a mate? Well, it seems that he's determined to keep this brood going, so he's just focused on feeding. And you've also been asking how long he's going to continue with this struggle. Well, I believe it's going to be right up until the point they're pretty self-sufficient, so at least a couple of weeks. He's got a lot of work still to do, so we'll be keeping an eye on him, certainly till the end of the series. Now then, Eagle Cam. If you've been watching, our live Eagle camera got completely steamed up across the weekend. We've pulled out all the stops to try and get it working. Let's go straight to the live camera now, and bingo at last. What a relief. We've got a view, and that's the female. That's the adult female on the left of the nest, just sheltering and indeed resting in the late evening sun with the chick underneath. Just literally 5 or 10 minutes ago, she came in to feed the chick. Let's take a look at that. She came in, and there's already prey around the nest that the male has been bringing. And what a, oh, the view just gets better and better now. I'm so happy that we've got this camera back up and running. This really is a truly intimate view of one of the country's most magnificent birds. And so from a rather sedate and regal eagle to a much more manic bird of prey. If you watched yesterday, you'll know that we managed to get a camera into a hen harrier nest, and it has to be said that the female is a truly feisty lady. Again, very intimate views into an otherwise hidden world of a bird that's rarely seen. Isla's a speciality, is a stronghold for hen harriers. That's the male passing food to his mate, who comes in to feed it to the chicks. She alone tears it up and feeds it to the chicks. Still 3 chicks in the nest and 2 eggs. It may be that one of those or 2 of those eggs were still to hatch. We don't know yet. But it seems that the female is getting a little bit bored with motherhood, because after she's fed the chicks, and with the male away for hours on end, he's often gone for some time hunting, she seems to just get bored, and in fact a little aggressive. And she'd start taking it out on our camera, fortunately, not on the chicks. Now, she's not upset by the camera because she sleeps by it, but she obviously just thinks it's a cracking good target to practice on. Fortunately, it's quite robust, and it's it's withstanding all of her clouts. But with her long-legged hits, I mean, this is a bird of prey that can easily take a young rabbit. Then she takes it out on the grass,